This episode of Death Battle is brought to you by Slim Jim.
Born to dying races and sent to brave new worlds, these two alien saviors are legendary.
And everybody wants to know who would kick whose ass in a fight. And I mean everyone.
Goku, the tenacious Super Saiyan.
And Superman, the Man of Steel.
To ensure no questions are left unanswered, we will be acknowledging every official resource for both combatants. Though the original writings hold precedence, no mistranslations allowed. Also, as he was retconned and rebuilt in 1986, we will be examining the modern Superman.
Considering Supes pre-86 could make up new superpowers on the fly and destroy entire solar systems by sneezing, probably a good idea. He's Wiz and I'm Boomstick.
And it's our job to analyze their weapons, armor, and skills to find out who would win a death battle. Kakarot was born to a low-class Saiyan warrior on the planet Vegeta. He narrowly escaped the extinction of his entire race when he was sent to Earth with a single, simple mission.
Destroy everything! Then he conveniently bumped his head and forgot about it all!
Dubbed Goku by his adoptive grandfather, his life revolves around combat. He cares little for anything else, unless food is involved.
Can I have another bowl, please?
At 12 years old, he was trained by Master Roshi in Kame Sennin Ryu, which pushes a person to superhuman levels.
Complementing his Saiyan biology, Goku's superhuman strength, speed, and senses skyrocketed. He developed numerous fighting techniques, including the fast-moving after image and the dragon throw, his trademark grapple.
At 15, he was already so powerful that the only worthy teachers left were gods and a talking cat, but mostly gods! He was only a kid and his power level was already enormous.
It's over 9,000!
Not yet! Okay, now it is.
What? 9,000?
False! In the Japanese manga, Goku's power level at that time was 8,000. But it doesn't even matter because power levels are absurd. The entire point of introducing them was to show how unreliable and meaningless they were. By relying on power levels, the villains constantly underestimated the heroes. Therefore, using them to judge Goku's abilities is pointless. Besides, the Daizenshu says that...
Die what now?
The official Dragon Ball Encyclopedia. It states power levels eventually become immeasurable. Not because they are so high they can't be measured, but because the characters, and hopefully the audience, have realized just how futile these numbers are.
I'm still 10 times stronger than you are.
That may be true, but strength isn't the only thing that matters.
We cannot judge Goku by his power level. Nor can we through power scaling, the theory that he can achieve the same feats as lesser Dragon Ball characters. Goku's abilities are tailored to his personal training and experiences, not to mention anatomy.
I can breathe in space and you can't.
However, Goku does have a knack for mimicking ki techniques.
Ki is metaphysical, made up of things such as vigor, courage, and being in one's true mind.
It's basically a kind of natural life force energy and is a fundamental component of Taoist medicine and martial arts. Oh, and it's not magic.
Dragon Ball creates a very distinct difference between ki and magic. Ki is dependent on the physical ability of the user, and magic users like Babidi are clearly using something different. Goku harnesses and manipulates his ki energy
into badass lasers and stuff like ki blasts, energy barriers, and the Destructo Disc, which he totally stole from Krillin. The solar flare blinds opponents, and the spirit bomb puts energy from other things into a giant death ball that takes freaking forever to make.
And energy taken from sentient beings must be voluntary. The spirit bomb is fueled by positive energy, which is only effective against those filled with negative energy, aka evil. In the Super Android 13 film, Goku actually absorbs the ki gathered from the spirit bomb, becoming one with it, transforming and manipulating the energy himself.
But his two best moves are the Dragon Fist, where he supercharges his punch with a golden ki dragon, and the one and only Kamehameha, a giant focus beam which every kid in the world has always wanted to do. Don't lie, you've tried it.
Goku also uses ki for telekinesis and high-speed flight. He can even sense the power and location of other ki sources, then teleport directly to them with instant transmission.
Which is light speed!
You dematerialize and travel as a mass of light.
Again, false. This is another mistake in translation. According to the original manga, instant transmission is, well, instant. Its only flaw is that it requires concentrated focus.
It's no good! I can't concentrate!
Also, he can read minds.
Wait, what? Is there no limit to this ki thing?
There is. Goku draws from a finite pool of ki energy. So to increase his power, Goku perfected the art of Kaioken. This amplifies Goku's ki, multiplying his strength, speed, defense, and so on.
Only one problem. It puts a giant strain on his body and could even kill him.
Kaioken times 20!
But Goku does not have to rely solely on his ki. He wields the Power Pole, a magical staff which expands and contracts.
When he's hurt, eating a Senzu bean heals him up. And to get around, he rides the Flying Nimbus, a flying cloud which probably tastes like cotton candy.
Still, the Kaioken was Goku's trump card for some time until a fateful battle with the tyrant Frieza, who pushed Goku past his limits to achieve the legendary form of Super Saiyan.
There are four different levels of Super Saiyan, each drastically boosting his power.
Like the Kaioken, each form does burden his body, though Goku has trained to minimize this.
Super Saiyan 3 multiplies the already combined power of Super Saiyan 2 by 4, but comes at a horrible price. That hair. Oh, and it pretty much destroys his body while he's using it, but my god, the hair!
Fortunately for Goku, the life-sapping Super Saiyan 3 form would be trumped by his final transformation, Super Saiyan 4. This form alters his body to better endure the 4,000 times power increase.
Complete with pink fur and eyeshadow! Fear the ultimate form!
With each transformation, minus full power Super Saiyan 1, Goku loses some self-control, becoming more violent and instinct-prone.
When I'm at this power level, it's hard for me to listen to reason. I just lose control.
Goku's greatest strength is his tenacity and never-give-up attitude. He does not fight to defeat others, he fights to defeat himself. However, this may also be his greatest weakness.
He prefers a fair fight, eager to see his opponent's maximum potential.
He's about to reach his maximum! This could be your last chance!
I want him to reach his maximum! I want to fight him when he's at his best!
But when the whole world is at stake, well, hindsight is 20/20.
And although he's more than tough enough to survive in a vacuum, he clearly needs oxygen, so no breathing in space.
Plus, well, Goku's not very bright. Despite some basic schooling from Roshi, Goku has never had a day of certified formal education in his life. It took him years just to learn how to drive.
But why the hell would Goku need to drive a car?
Even so, Goku understands his weaknesses. To him, a formal education would just be a waste of time. He is already a genius when it comes to martial arts.
And even if he does get the hell beaten out of him, he improves with every fight.
And that is what Goku is all about. He thrives on becoming stronger and bursting limits, and has overcome every obstacle in his way.
Even marriage.
Goku might just be the greatest martial artist in fictional history.
What? What are you?
I am the hope of the universe. I am the answer to all living things that cry out for peace. Allied to good! Nightmare to you!
My son was in the bus. He saw what Clark did.
Kal-El was born to a high-class scientist on the planet Krypton. He narrowly escaped the destruction of his home world when his father sent him to Earth with the goal of preserving human life.
Well, what a coincidence! Except for the whole saving human life thing. After landing on Earth, he was found and raised by the Kents, who decided to name him Clark. And weren't they surprised when they found out he was an alien with superpowers?
After discovering his true heritage, Clark refused to accept his Kryptonian side. He subconsciously developed mental barriers that blocked him from attaining his full power, which he would work to uncover throughout the rest of his life.
Stupid power-limiting brain!
After graduating college in 2 years and traveling the world as a secret superhero, Clark moved to the city of Metropolis as an investigative reporter, and donned the red and blue to publicly announce his presence as the Superman, defender of truth, justice, and the American way, until he renounced his American citizenship.
My old-mannered Clark kept his identity a secret with the brilliant disguise of nerdy glasses and wimpy demeanor.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Proving that people only see what they want to believe.
Boomstick, that's surprisingly profound.
Since then, his power's been pretty inconsistent, mostly due to the writers doing whatever the hell they please.
Well, there is a legitimate explanation. Superman's powers are dependent on the ultrasolar rays of the sun. By absorbing yellow or blue sunlight, his power rises. However, he cannot absorb sunlight from a red star. So, if you take away a yellow sun, you slowly take away Superman's powers.
He's solar-powered! They call him the world's first superhero, but sounds more like the world's first hippie to me.
Now, the intensity of solar radiation disperses the further away it gets from its source, so the closer Superman is to the sun, the more solar radiation he'll absorb.
So he gathers more power the higher he gets? He is a hippie!
In the Justice League series, Our World's at War, Superman actually spent 15 minutes inside the sun. When he resurfaced, he was powerful enough to effortlessly move planets.